One of the questions I get asked all the time is, can you patent software? Well, the short answer is yes. And I want to talk in this video about software patents and some strategies for getting software patents. Hi, my name is John Farrell. I'm a patent attorney. Welcome back to my channel. Now, there's a lot of confusion about software patents, especially on the internet, because in the last decade or so, there's been a fair amount of hostility in the patent office over granting software patents. So in this video, we're going to talk a bit about that. But before we talk about software patents, let's talk about patents in general. Historically, patents have been useful for protecting machines, things like cars and tractors, processes, that is methods of manufacturing something, compositions of matter, that is chemical compounds, and articles of manufacture, things like pencils, things that come out of a manufacturing process. Software is a bit of an oddball because it doesn't fit easily into one of those four categories. And consequently, a lot of analysis has gone into whether software itself is patentable. Software patents really took off right before the dot-com boom in the late 1990s. And we saw that there were a lot of abstract ideas being patented during this period. There were some court cases that were permissive with respect to software patents, and we began to see software patents increasing in both number and scope. And some would say that software patents got a little bit out of hand because clever attorneys were finding ways of patenting very trivial ideas once done by hand that were now being done by computers. This led to some pernicious activity, not only in the patent office, but in the judicial system, where we saw patent owners trying to enforce relatively simple patent claims that were embodied in a computer program. The judicial system shifted, the pendulum swung, and about 10 years ago, there was pushback in some cases where the Supreme Court and other courts following decided that abstract inventions were not appropriate for patenting. And it took a while for the patent office to understand and to apply this new standard. And consequently, for a number of years in the mid-2000s, it was very difficult to get a patent on a software product. Fortunately, we're beginning to understand better what abstract means as it's applied to software patents, and the patent office has relaxed its standards in allowing patents involving software. So what is patentable with respect to software, and what isn't patentable? Clearly, the courts have strongly come out against the patenting of abstract ideas. For example, it's not possible to get a patent on the abstract invention of buying low and selling high. So generally speaking, ideas that have been in the public domain cannot receive a patent just by virtue of executing computer steps just to perform those abstract ideas. The European Patent Office has an interesting standard called the technical effect test. It requires that any patent involving software or involving a process do something useful, that it have some technical effect. And we might say that this technical effect test is also useful as we think about what is patentable in the US as well, because arguably this technical effect test is slightly more strict than the standards that are currently implemented in the US. So what would be an example of a technical effect? Well, for example, a computer program that controlled a machine that cures rubber and produces tires. You pour liquid rubber into a machine, a computer program does some processing, and a few minutes later, the machine opens and out rolls a tire. That would be a technical effect that would be generated by a computer program. So in the US, our goal is to avoid abstract ideas when trying to patent software. And we can avoid these abstract ideas by going back to the basic principles of patenting. We want our inventions to look like machines. We want them to look like processes. If we can tie our computer software to a machine, it's much more likely that we're going to be able to get those patents allowed. Now, I have two safe harbors that I use when preparing and filing patent applications related to software. Now, these really truly aren't safe harbors. Maybe they're more like touchstones, but I've found that if I do one of these two things, I can generally get the patent allowed. The first touchstone that I use is the only by computer concept. This only by computer concept is tied to the idea that there are certain functions that only a computer software program can do. For example, if you're looking for malware on a network, it really takes a computer program to go search and find that malware. So this would be an example of something that only a computer program can do. And certainly it seems to me that this process, this machine, this computer program machine that's capable of going out and finding and destroying malware would certainly be patentable. And that argument has generally held up in my cases in the patent office. The second touchstone involves feedback. I don't have case law to support this, although examiners have asked me about this. But I will say I have been very successful getting patents allowed that involve feedback, where the feedback creates an improving process. It's a process with feedback. The process gets better with each cycle through the process using a feedback loop. For example, this is the basis of artificial intelligence, and we know that artificial intelligence software programs are being allowed in large numbers currently. So these two touchstones might be useful to you when thinking about avoiding abstract ideas. Number one, is it something that only a computer program can do? And number two, is there a feedback loop that makes the system better with each cycle through the feedback loop? Okay, this is really all I have today to say about software patents. I hope to do more of these videos on software patents in the future because it's a super interesting topic. Please leave comments if you have something you'd like to add or something you'd like to discuss. Thanks so much for visiting my channel again today. Look forward to seeing you next time.